Okay, finally got it to be live.
Next weekend is the women's conference. What have you guys got plans figured out yet at this point?
Of course we do.
Hey, we're on top of it. Trust
me. We're gonna. Brian got us a place to stay with his points. Thank you, Brian. And we're gonna stay Friday night. Some have to work Friday, and
their bosses.
Yeah, their bosses are making them work.
That's awful.
If anybody, well, I think Kathy and I are going to get down early and get the rooms and get the keys and stuff set up. And then,
Jen Lynn posted that she can come for the whole thing.
Oh, good. Oh, then maybe she'll
come. Does she need a ride?
I need to.
I don't know. I'm going to reach out to her. I think I'm the only one that has to come late.
Aww.
Okay. And then, Bobby has to work, so she's going to.
Hey, Bobby, do you have to work? But you know where it is.
Yeah, I do. I'll get it.
And then it's till noon, and then if anybody wants to do anything afterwards, I think Angela was interested in doing shopping, and then there's a lot there.
Soap stores?
Soap shops.
And we need to pray for Jennifer, yeah. And hopefully she can get to a point that she can go with us.
Yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, be better, Jen.
Because she's so looking forward to this, and I just hope they can get her.
You guys will be here. Do you know when you're coming in?
Some of us will be here through the 7th, all the way up to the 17th.
Okay.
I won't be until that Sunday.
Okay.
But I'll be here for the rest of that week.
We'll just need to coordinate to be able to get you a key to get in and out of the building and the code for the alarm system, because if it came in and the alarm system went off, my guess is y'all wouldn't look like you belong here.
It's
come in on that side.
But you know what? This is a safer church than any other church.
That's how I feel too. I don't think we need to worry about anybody breaking in.
No.
Exactly.
Can they use do you need any like air mattresses or like linen?
The Bible just said a couple of
They said no, but we
have some air mattresses too.
Yeah, they don't want to inconvenience us, but it wouldn't be an inconvenience.
You know you are getting air mattresses.
Yeah. Okay.
Deal with it.
But there's only be like 4 or 5 of us.
Okay.
Sometimes it might not even be all 5. It could just probably be this me and somebody else.
Okay.
So I don't know who's coming down with me. So I was just basically trying
to. I've got a queen size one if 2 of you want to.
Hey, you know this is on Facebook. Right?
No.
That's what he's doing.
It's better to have them in our
hands. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we'll get some here for you in the meantime.
Thank you so much.
Let's see. Bike week is coming up. David, you're going to be here. Do y'all have an idea of what you want to do this bike week?
Well, like I said, whoever wants to team up with us.
I kind of like to do pretty well the same thing we've done before, like give out the Bibles. But I thought maybe if we can get set up close to where you all at,
or
maybe
then
we can just be back and forth. Yeah.
Or you can just come over and we can walk together.
We can walk together.
That'd be great.
Yeah, we can set our bikes up and then like out from where they're at.
We don't really do a whole lot of. Except stand there. And
we usually stand there and we're. Why do you put up a note?
I will not ride a man on my bike. It's got to be a female.
Oh, yeah.
Last
I call you Jeff when you leave.
We just set up and we give away, Bibles and stickers.
Right. Well,
and we had a note that we would pray with people if they.
I said, we can team up and we can walk around together.
Yeah.
You can see what we do.
Okay.
And if there's a tent, it would be much more private to take them in there and pray with them.
Yeah.
Because out on the street, it's so loud, it's hard to even talk.
Like I said, it's an experience for both of us to.
Okay. Do you know where at Boot Hill you're going to be? Do you have a sense?
It's right next to Boot Hill Saloon, that's all I know. Right outside of Boot Hill.
Probably in the parking lot?
The field right next to it. Where you put the porta potties and a barbecue place.
That must be over on the side there.
Yeah.
It's on the parking lot side? Because across from there is a parking lot, too, right?
Right, but this is right next door to Boot Hill.
Okay.
That's all I know.
Boot Hill is a parking lot on the right facing you. Across the street's rental.
Okay.
Where Rosette charges to park there.
Yes.
We're there from, I think it's from 8:30 to 5 o'clock.
Okay.
We get out before the partiers come in.
All right. We'll probably be down there with some of the partiers. We did last year.
Well, I can always hang out for a little while.
Okay.
I just don't want to stick around when it gets real rowdy.
Oh, that's only Friday and Saturdays.
Yeah.
Well, you must know.
Yeah. 39 years of them. Yeah, pretty much kind of done with science.
Also, we're still planning the bug run in the spring. It looks like Bobby's bike is going to win right now, except there's not a target on it.
Make sure you watch that schedule, Bobby, that you don't make you work. Very
you watch. When we put the sticker on it, she'll have cleaned it, and she won't hit a bug. also, the first weekend is the Tomoka Christian Church. Can you tell us a little bit about that, Roger?
Okay, it's going to be from 9 to 1. It's bike blessing is what it is. And in the mornings, there'll be donuts and coffee. And from 10:30 on until it runs out to 1, which we haven't run up to yet, it's a free barbecue for bikers.
Okay.
You park, we escort you to the registration table, get a food ticket, if you want your bike blessed.
We'll try to run
afterwards. We're going to have a run, but we're not sure now who's going to be a renegade, but now it might be somewhere else.
Okay. We'll try to run up right after church that week.
Like I said, if you know how many people are calling, we're running low. You can have Barb text me.
Okay.
You're part of the local rider, so you should get to eat.
Okay. We had a good ride yesterday. That was a lot of fun. We went down to the Swamp House. All right. Any other announcements that I missed? No? Okay. Crank your eye.
Oh. That's why she turns it on loud.
Oh, wait. Let me just ask one question. How many of you have a Bible?
Where's your Bible?
And you know where it is.
And you know where it is. David has a tendency to this place.
Where's your Bible? Okay, are you ready?
Yes.
Please stand.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love.
It's been an interesting week, a lot of things going on. But Jennifer and Brian are still at the hospital. Jennifer's been in all week since Monday. So I'd like to have a prayer for her this morning. And then also, we know of some other needs, and we want to keep those folks in prayer as well. So let's pray for some of our folks. We know some folks that are struggling right now. So let's just kind of open up the prayer with that before we kind of dig in this morning. Lord, thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy and for all the things that you do for us. We know that your will is hard to understand sometimes, but we also know that you are the creator of all things. We know that you have a purpose in everything that you allow to happen. And just, Lord, we just ask that you continue to kind of reach out and hold on to those people that we care about and are a part of our family. Keep them safe. Keep them focused on you. And no matter what, Lord, let nothing in their hearts interfere with your desires and their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We are getting toward the end of the statement of faith. This week, we're going to do baptism and communion. Next week, Dave is going to cover the church. And then the final one we're going to do is on marriage. And so, that'll kind of conclude the series that we've been doing on the statement of faith. So this morning, we're going to talk about baptism and communion. But I want to start with this kind of simple thing.
We forgot the mouse this morning, so okay.
Okay, we're going to start with Mark in the first chapter, and we're going to read 1 through 12, and we're going to go to 1 Corinthians. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all of the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn apart and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. Let's jump to 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, starting at verse 23. "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" When a person joins the military, and some of you have military service, you know that there is an oath. And it's similar to this. And the joke is, state your name. "Do solemnly swear or affirm that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me, according to regulations and the Uniform Code of Military Justice, so help me God." Even the President has an oath. His oath is very similar. It says, "I do solemnly swear or affirm that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States." It is not uncommon to swear an oath when you begin something. It is a practice that goes beyond the church. However, these particular passages and these particular oaths include God. It does not remove God from our country. And despite what people say about separation of church and state, this is pretty common practice when you look at the scriptures. Every Roman soldier at the time of Christ participated in what was called the Sacramentum Militare. It was an oath taken by soldiers in pledging their loyalty to the Republic of Rome. It is the sacramentum, as pertaining to both the law and the military, indicates the religious basics for both institutions. But soldiers swear that they will faithfully execute all of the emperor's commands. The interesting thing about this oath that the Roman soldiers had to take was that it basically put their lives on hold for the Republic. Their requirement was they would do what was commanded of them. The hardest part to remember about being a Christian is that when you gain that faith in Christ, there is an oath that goes with it. And there is a requirement that you will follow the commands of Christ. The Roman soldiers, if they were in a battle and the legion was destroyed and decimated by the battle, whoever was left was required to state the sacramentum again, so that they would understand that their very lives, were committed to something else. And then, sometime around the second century, during the time of Severus, and Severus is not just from Harry Potter, by the way, Emperor Severus required that it be done every single year on January 3rd. And so every year on January 3rd, if you were in the military, you were again required to state the oath. Today we're going to focus on some of the sacraments of the church, which for us is really baptism and communion. And we're going to try to understand the basics of what those are and why it's important. We make a lot of commitments in our life. If you're married, you make a commitment. If you're in a relationship, you make a commitment. If you buy a motorcycle and put it on a loan, you make a commitment. And the Christian commitment goes back to the Nicene Creed, which was around 325. And it says, we believe that Christ is the Son of God. We believe that we are saved by grace. We believe that there is a calling on our lives beyond what we do day to day. And those commitments are as important to us as anything in the world. Because just like the Roman soldier, it requires that we basically give our lives to what God calls us to do. If we don't do that and we can't follow that commitment, then we really aren't committed to the faith. The scripture says that there are two kinds of believers. There are those that believe in their head and there are those that believe in their heart. And Paul says that if you're going to be a follower of Christ, you need to quit eating milk and begin to eat meat. Our statement of faith says this: we believe that Christ, through the Bible, told us to do two things so that we can remember what he did for us and to be identified as Christ followers. There's nothing mystical or inherently powerful in the ordinances of the church. These are symbolic acts of faith in Christ in which all believers should participate. And then it defines, baptism is a symbolic act where the Christian is immersed or covered in water in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Through baptism, we identify ourselves as followers of Christ, both for ourselves and as a witness to others that we accepted salvation through Christ. And our statement on communion says this: communion or the Lord's Supper is a symbolic act where Christians partake of the bread and juice or the fruit of the vine as a remembrance of Christ's death for our salvation. I want us to understand something this morning as we talk about these two concepts. There is nothing that those two acts will do to build your faith. Your faith is built on Christ. The action of communion and baptism are a representation and a symbol that you are committed to the calling that Christ has on your life. We don't believe in transubstantiation, which is that when you take communion, that it turns into the actual body and blood of Christ. We don't believe that baptism brings forward the Holy Spirit in your life, because baptism of the Holy Spirit comes at the time of salvation. We don't believe that those two acts will do anything except make you commit to the faith that you claim. That's our statement of faith. And we're going to dig into both of those concepts. But you know what, Barb? Let's go ahead and play this. Quite like that. We don't do it quite that way. But God bless them if they went through it. If you survive that baptism, you are blessed. Let's talk about this. Why is immersion important in our concept of baptism? The Greek word used for baptism in Mark 1 is a word from the Greek called baptizo. And it means to dip repeatedly. It's not a simple under the thumb kind of thing. It's not a sprinkling of water. It means to dip repeatedly for the purposes. There's no question that John the Baptist was baptizing by immersion. When you read what the description is of what he did, both historically as well as scripturally, it was the word baptizo, not baptiste. Now you're going to wonder, why is there a pickle up there? I want to explain that to you. The Greek poet Nicander explains baptismo this way. When you become a follower of Christ, you are washed in the blood and become a new creature. But in order for that change to take place in your life, you have to be more than just cleansed. You have to be pickled in vinegar. And when you're put into vinegar, it creates a whole new food group. It's no longer just a cucumber. Pickles are not cucumbers. And cucumbers are not pickles. And so when you become baptized in the Holy Spirit and you become a part of the following of Christ, you are washed in the blood of Christ, you become a pickle. And if you don't become a pickle, nobody knows you're different than any other cucumber. That's kind of our relationship with Christ. While he initially washes us and cleans us just like you would a cucumber, he then dips us in the power of his love and creates in us a new being. You're never going to look at pickles again, are you? The same way. Baptism represents essentially the first step in following Christ. It tells the world and commits to you that I am a follower of Christ's teachings and beliefs. You know, we see a lot of people that say, I'm a Christ follower. They say, they use the word Christian. Well, there's a lot of Christians out there that are not Christ followers. They get locked into something in the intellectual realm, and they fail to get down to the heart of the matter, which is, am I different than what I was when I started? There is nothing inherently powerful about baptism, but it is your oath and your commitment to the world that you are a Christ follower and you are different. It marks that point in time. I know Roger was military. That point where you state the oath, you are different. As a soldier, you are different. And as you state the oath of your salvation and get baptized, you state to yourself and to the world, I am a different. I don't think baptism should be as simple as putting on your underwear. But I absolutely believe that baptism, while it doesn't make you saved, it tells the world what your faith is. It represents for us this death of going under the water, that renewing of who we are as we come out. If you remember in John 4, Jesus talked to the woman at the well. In verse 14, he says, Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again. Whoever drinks of the water I give them shall never thirst. Baptism doesn't make your faith, but it states your faith. That's the reason we believe in baptism by immersion. You can't get that from any other way. It's a commitment to go under the water. Now, do we need to be baptized every year? I don't know. Roman soldiers stated the oath every year. Do I believe that baptism ought to occur at that moment in your Christian walk where you have made a significant change and you want to commit even more so? Maybe. Because baptism by itself doesn't do anything except state, I'm going to be a new person. I'm going to be a new soul. I know a lot of people who've been baptized multiple times because they've gotten close to God, they've fallen away, they've come back, and they've asked to be baptized again. I don't have a problem with that. That's the commitment and the symbolic act of saying, I'm going to be different. Many of us have gone through marital problems. I got remarried again a couple years ago. But it required a statement of faith and a commitment. required in oath. If you're going to make an oath to certain things, you ever, anybody ever really read the paperwork that comes with a loan? It's an oath that you're going to pay it. It's an oath that if something happens to you, you're still going to pay it. It's an oath that if something happens to you and you die, somebody else is going to pay it for you. It's an oath. And baptism is an oath. It says, I am a new creature in Christ. One of the folks from the church that I had previously in Tallahassee contacted me recently and said, would you baptize me when I'm down next weekend? And we will probably do a baptism next weekend. They haven't figured out how yet or where.
The ocean.
Yeah.
But the ocean seems like a good spot.
That's where it lodges.
If not, we'll do what I did in Tallahassee. We used to have a pig trough. We filled it up.
I did that.
Kind of like that guy did. Only I won't dive on her. A couple of years ago, I had the pleasure of actually baptizing all three of my daughters. Baptism is all about the commitment. We don't do infant baptism. We do dedications. But we don't do infant baptism. Why? Because they can't commit. This is your commitment and no one else's. Secondly, George Santea, who is an atheist, you all have heard this saying before, those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Communion is that remembrance of the grace of God for us to recall. While baptism is a form of telling the world, communion is a very personal, private decision to remember the grace of God in Christ's death. It is meant for you as an individual. I remember as a kid, my father retired from the military, became a minister. And I can remember when he would do communion, there would be those folks that would jump up and run down first. Because they wanted everybody to see them take communion. And they missed the idea that communion is a personal process, not a public process. It's that time when you recall what's important to you. My daughter was up last weekend. And the baby, y'all saw. What a cutie, huh? I can say that, I'm a grandpa. But you sent me a picture this week, and one of the things she sent me was her playing in just a diaper. And she said, Nikki baby. And you know what? I recalled immediately that's what she was like. She would get up in the morning, strip her clothes off, climb out of the crib, and run down the hall and make it. But that was my memory of what was important. That was my recall of what happened. And communion is that recall and that remembrance for me of what Christ has done for me in his grace. It's not a public act. We might do it publicly, and our intention is, we've not done it here at the church since we started. And our intention is to start doing communion at least quarterly. But I really wanted to wait till we got through the statement of faith because I want people to really understand what communion's about. It's not about going up and getting something and making you feel holy. It's about you feeling holy and going up and remembering what Christ did to get you to where you are. Communion is Christ's directive to remember what he did. If you recall the whole story, the night before Christ began his trials, he washed the feet of the disciples, dried them, fed them, and said, "When you drink of the cup, remember me. When you eat the bread, remember me." You know, most of the time we remember things. Anybody have a food they dislike? Give me some. Pickles, right? No.
Beans.
Huh?
Beans.
Beans. Can't stand beans. What else?
Beets.
Beets.
Liver.
Liver.
I don't like the
beets right now.
Really?
Let me ask you something. If you get anything in your mouth that resembles that taste, do you recall immediately what it is? That's the power of taste and smell. You have a stronger memory field in your taste and your smell than you do any other time. I can remember we grew up in Frostburg. But when the paper mill, the wind shifted from Westernport up to Frostburg, you immediately knew it was the paper mill. You could almost taste it. It was that bad. Right?
Yep. Yeah.
Can you imagine if we lived our lives as believers in Christ and every single thing that comes to our mind reminds us of what Christ did? How would we be different than who we are today? Most of the time, we forget all of the things that Christ does. But if we could just put to it that memory, we would be different people. And our world would be different. You know, we can't be followers of Christ without recalling the gift of his death and resurrection. Now, it's nice to... how many times do you go into a store in October and you go, "Oh, Christmas stuff's up already"? Wouldn't it be nice if every single morning we got up and we read our Bibles and we communed with God and remembered what was done for us? Wouldn't we be different? If we want to be the kind of Christ follower that Christ calls us to be, we got to recall. It's not always about being out. It's not about the stuff that's important to us. Bible said on any motorcycle in the world. We all know that. We saw that today. She has no loyalty to any motorcycle. She lights them up. Because she remembers what it's like to ride, regardless of what's under her. she remembers what it's like to be on the road making those turns and hitting that gas. That's important to her.
Shifting gears.
Yeah, shifting gears. She likes to shift gears. It's not the bike. It's the ride. It's not the faith that will grow from communion. It's communion ought to come from our faith. It ought to come from who we are. And every single time we engage in that activity, we ought to stop and say, thank you, Christ, what you've done. You know, some churches use wine. Some churches use grape juice. Baptist Church moved away from wine a long time ago because they became teetotalers. I don't know that that's scriptural, but whatever. There are churches that do both, that have both wine and grape juice. But it's not about that. It's about remembering the blood of Christ. You can get caught up on whether it's leavened bread or unleavened bread or wheat bread or marble rye, or some people will only use crusty bread. I remember at a church one time they'd go around with these crusty loaves of bread and you were supposed to reach and pull a piece off. I was like, ugh. I don't know, I put my fingers behind somebody else and take a chunk of bread. So I try to find something way up here. It ought not to be about any of that. Communion is that act of remembrance. And that can happen every single day. The sacraments of the church are remembrances. Salvation steps. If you've been baptized in the past and you feel that there's something different in you and you want to be rededicated and rebaptized, I'm okay with that. Just talk to me. And we'll make arrangements for that. The thing I push to you to recall on baptism is that I said to you, it's not like putting on your underwear. It's a commitment. Saying, I am different. And communion, when we have communion, I'm not going to stand and look and say, who took it, who didn't. That's not my business. Communion is about you remembering at a very personal level what Christ has done for you. So when we start that process, we haven't even talked about whether it be wine or juice. We'll figure that one out. Maybe we'll do both, I don't know. Maybe it won't be juice at all. Maybe it'll be mango juice because we're in Florida. But I want you to understand this morning that the statement of faith is labeled statement of faith because it's about you stating what you believe. And these are just two more things in our statement of faith that tell us that as believers, this is who we are. Nothing magical. You're not going to come out of the water and heaven separate like when Christ came out. If he drives you into the wilderness, I'm okay with that. There's a lot of people I'd like to see driven in the wilderness. What's that saying? It's not the destination, it's the ride. You your decisions this morning are your decisions. If you choose to participate in communion, right? That represents for you the remembrance of who Christ is. If you choose to want to be baptized, I promise I won't dive on you. I won't pick you up, and I won't slam you under the water, maybe. Depends on who it is. I can hold some people down a little bit longer.
You're not done yet.
You are quite clean and pickled. But remember this. We are called to be pickles. We are called to be pickled and different than who we were before. And that's the nature of our faith. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord God, as we come before you this morning, we know that your love and mercy is what got us here. We know that you have called us to be not just Christians, but Christ followers. We know that you call us to take that oath for you, and that there is more to our faith than just being and sitting. But there is a calling on all of our hearts, a calling that you have purposed in our lives. And I ask, Lord, that you teach us what that is this morning. Help us to figure out what you want us to be and who you want us to be. We can't do this on our own, but we can do it with your strength and your love. And we ask, Lord, this morning that you bring that to our full attention. Let us remember who you are. Let us recall those words, do this in remembrance of me. Jesus' name, amen. Stand.
Stripes and marks and all.
comes up with me. I break the bread and drink the wine. Comes up with me.
I would say to you simply this. The scripture is very clear. Do this in remembrance of me. That's the calling that we have. Everything we do, whether it be feeding the homeless, taking care of others, loving each other, loving other people, it comes down to that simple statement. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's circle up and have some prayer. Heaven saints, as they get themselves prepared to come down, and all the stuff that's going forward, you know that there's a lot of 6 weeks out there as well.
Okay. Right. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this message today. We ask, Lord, that you help us in our everyday walk, that all that we do, that we can look and say that it is a remembrance of what you've done for us. Lord, we pray for those that we all know that are sick, that are struggling with things, that you just be with them. We pray, Lord, for heaven's saints, that as we go into the back week time, Lord, that we can all start preparing our hearts and minds now to reach out to those that are lost. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name I pray.
Have a good race,
but that'd be a while.
Yeah, I was trying to tell if it's
okay.
Good. How's all trucks doing?
Good. They sit in there. They got a lazy. That day we were trucking, got a lazy drive.
Right. Got that one just for you.
I'll take some of these.
Probably okay.
Because I invite a lot of people to church. So.
That'd be great. Take some of the cards, too.
A dumpster or something.
That was me.
Yeah, I thought it was.
Yeah.